When describing his approach to world building in The Wheel of Time, Robert Jordan once said, "I have attempted to treat channeling as if it were a form of science and engineering rather than magic. You might say that the laws of thermodynamics apply in altered form." Let's take a deeper look at how channeling the One Power might be based on existing physics principles. Channeling is one of the most important elements of the world of the Wheel of Time, affectionately referred to as Randland. The One Power represents Randland's overall source of magic, and channeling is how gifted or trained individuals use this magic. When someone channels the One Power, it's described as a process of weaving an assortment of threads into a pattern. The threads of the One Power come in five types: air, earth, fire, water, and spirit. The different patterns, together with the different types of threads, create different effects, with some patterns more complicated than others. The text of The Wheel of Time gives very little in the way of visual descriptions of these weaves, or even what the threads look like, and the visual depiction of the One Power is an active topic of speculation in discussions of the upcoming TV series. So we already see that geometry and elements are an important aspect of channeling, giving the process some similarity to physics. Robert Jordan once said, "I tried to structure channeling as if it were a science or technology. No eye of newt, hair of dog. There are real limits, there are rules, there are technological structures to channeling, which I think are fairly obvious to anyone who looks at it." So in Jordan's mind, channeling is much more of a physical phenomenon than what we usually think of as magic. In an interview at DragonCon, Jordan was once asked, regarding the One Power, in a universal sense, like your physics background, is it more of a force like gravity would be, or is it something more on a quantum level? Is it on a quantum level in your universe, or is it a macro power? Jordan answered, "I think you're going to have to think of it as being on a quantum level." Now, let's unpack what this means. By quantum level, physicists mean the very small, very fundamental scales of the universe. If you take any matter that we interact with on a daily basis and you keep breaking it down into smaller pieces, you eventually reach the level of the atom. Atoms are further broken down into electrons flying around the outside with protons and neutrons inside the central nucleus. The reason we call this the quantum level is because when you examine the physical behavior of these subatomic particles, two very strange things begin to happen. First, things that used to be continuous become discrete. For example, in our macro world, you and I can have any level of energy we want. Well, except at 5:30 in the morning. But in general, we can have our physical energy take on any value we want. 1 joule, 100 joules, 1,000,000 joules, 0 joules, and any values in between. For us, energy is a continuous variable. But on the quantum level, energy is discrete. An electron can't have any energy level it wants. Its energy level lives on a ladder, and the electron has to hop between the rungs on the ladder. This is why, for example, neon lights produce such sharp colors, because the electrons are falling between the same rungs on the ladder, producing light of a constant wavelength based on the energy difference. This is sort of like what's going on with channeling. A weave has to fit together just right, or it falls apart. You might say that what you can accomplish with a weave is quantized along very specific possibilities. Second, things that used to be localized become smeared out. For us, position is a nice, well-defined concept. Right now, I am definitely in my lab, at my university, in Northeast Florida, on planet Earth. But on the quantum level, position is fuzzy. An electron can never really say where it's located, just that it's very likely to be found within a certain region. Its position is governed by probability. It could be found in any number of locations on successive measurement. This again is sort of like what's going on with channeling and with being Tevieran. And Aes Sedai is literally making the improbable happen using these threads that are spread out over space. So what might be going on quantum mechanically with the One Power? Well, I can think of three possibilities. First, zero-point energy. Zero-point energy might give us an answer to the question of where does the power for the One Power come from? In physics, energy has to come from somewhere. If an Aes Sedai picks up a trolloc with weaves of air and hurls them across the field of Merrill Orr, the trolloc's newfound kinetic energy has to come from somewhere. Now, if channeling the One Power is quantum mechanical, it might come from these discrete energy levels that we talked about earlier. In particular, it might come from the lowest rung on the ladder. In many quantum mechanical systems, the lowest rung is above zero energy, making it impossible for an electron to have zero total energy, and leaving a smidge of energy just waiting to be harvested somehow. Second possibility, interfering wave functions. Remember how I said that position gets fuzzy at the quantum level and probability reigns over electrons? Well, this probability is governed by something called the wave function that exists everywhere in space and determines the probability of finding an electron at a given location. When two wave functions meet, they can interfere with each other, meaning someone could control these probabilities. It's possible that threads of the one power have the ability to manipulate wave functions and therefore probabilities, or that they might be some sort of wave function themselves. Finally, channeling the one power might represent mastery over atomic elements. The matter we interact with is made of many types of atoms called elements, each of whom has its own ladder of energy levels. It's possible that the one power is a direct manipulation of those levels, like how physicists control the energy levels of quantum dots. If so, maybe the five powers represent mastery over the energy levels present in different phases of matter. Earth threads manipulate solids, water threads manipulate liquids, air threads manipulate gases, fire threads manipulate plasma, and spirit threads... What does spirit do anyway? So those are my thoughts on how channeling the one power might represent a manifestation of quantum mechanical effects. I base this line of reasoning on comments made by Robert Jordan himself, but what do you think? Are there other quantum principles that might be at play in channeling the one power? Let me know in the comments below, and I'll see you next time.